I didn't know.
That's not my thing. That's not my story.
Yep.
She should be waking up here pretty soon. Thank you. She's taking an hour on there. Because she woke up at 6. Wow. She's 56. Yeah. She should be waiting. You keep a drink?
Okay.
Starts at 9. There's no way.
The legend of the phoenix, all ends with the beginnings. What keeps the planet spinning? The force from the beginning.
Thank you. like you're. Do you know Mia in Texas? Yes.
She may not be here.
Awesome.
Yeah, I have not seen her. So she
does somewhere. Are you with Mina's group?
Yes.
Probably the best person to ask for
that. Right. Okay.
Did you see Logan out there by chance?
No.
She might do that.
I might not.
Over. Like I didn't even, I wasn't even invited.
So much.
I'm tired.
Yeah.
grow. That's what we think of it. The money went through, so the system's working at least.
It just takes
about 24 hours all the time.
Not do that abruptly, but it was pretty abrupt, so sorry. Oh, I feel like I'm on American Idol. Is the red supposed to be good for my complexion? I don't know. Are we good to go, or are we just waiting a few minutes? Okay, all right. Well, thank you guys so much for being here at 9:15 in the morning. I'm very impressed. Did everybody eat breakfast? Yes? Okay, it's the most important meal of the day, right? Okay, good. I am here to talk to you a little bit about student success and degree completion at UAF. My name is Ginny Kinney. I'm the director of the Academic Advising Center. We are located on the fifth floor of the Greening Building. Do you guys know which one's the Greening Building? I'm assuming you all probably went on a campus tour at some point. If you take the elevator up to the fifth floor, you hang a right, you can't miss us. We are there and we serve a lot of students. And first I'll tell you a little bit about the students we serve. So the Academic Advising Center specifically serves the largest major on campus. Can you guys guess what the largest major on campus is? Undeclared, right. So a lot of students, when they apply for admission, don't even know that there's an undeclared option, and then they're just like, well, anthropology. Okay, it's in the A's, I'll pick that one. Maybe you do want to major in anthropology. Maybe you just picked something because you weren't sure what to pick. You're welcome to come to our office. We have a lot of resources available for undeclared students or unsure students, or maybe you thought you came here wanting to study biology, and now you're like, I don't know if that's what I really wanted to do. But we serve all the undeclared and unsure students. So we also help non-degree seeking students. If you were a high school student that took some college classes while you're in high school, we help those students in the Advising Center as well. We're backup advisors for the UAF NANUC athletes. Is there any athletes in the auditorium here? NANUCs? Go NANUCs! You guys know that you can get into all of the hockey games and volleyball games and basketball games and rifle matches all for free, right, with your fees? So please go and support our NANUCs. We also advise pre-professional students. So like maybe you are thinking you want to go to law school eventually, or you want to be an architect, or you're thinking you want to be a dentist or a doctor or a physician's assistant. You can come to our office and we can help you sort of navigate prerequisites for those programs and ultimately help you when you get further along in your degree apply to those programs. So you're welcome to visit us for that. We also help, besides major exploration, we do a lot of other major exploration stuff. We use a lot of tools like Myers-Briggs. Have you heard of the MBTI? Have you heard of that? It's a personality assessment. You can do them for free online, although they're not legit. But you can come to our office and do any of these assessments for free, free of charge to you guys. So we have the Strong Interest Inventory, which is like an interest assessment to help you narrow down maybe on a major or a future career. It's really fun, and I love talking to students about it. We do have career advising in our office. Actually, Nicole's here. She can give a wave. She is our career services advisor, so if you have questions about internships, or maybe you're applying for an on-campus job and you've like never written a resume in your life, we have a ton of resources on our career services website. Check it out. And she's happy to meet with you, too, to do a mock interview or help write your cover letter, anything like that. She is willing to help you out with that. The other thing we do is we help with grade appeal advising. So let's say at the end of the semester, you and your professor disagree on what your final grade should be. You can come to our office and we can help sort of navigate that process a little bit. So let's see here. So just to tell you a little bit about what we're going to talk about today, and hopefully you guys, if you have questions at any time, I'm totally informal. Raise your hand, shout it out. I want to answer your question, so I don't like to wait till the end because then you forget. So we're going to talk a little bit about FERPA, which I think got drilled into your parents pretty hard these last couple days, but I'm going to tell you guys a little bit about it and what that means and what it means for you. We're going to talk about mandatory academic advising at UAF. We're going to talk about your relationship with your advisor and what working with your academic advisor looks like. And then academically, where do I stand? Why is it important to be in good standing? We're going to talk a little bit about that. And then lastly, we're going to talk about important dates to remember. And there's even like a little cue at the bottom of the slide that says, take out your phone and take a picture of the slide, because there's some important dates that you want to keep in your mind during this semester while you're taking classes. So any questions before we start? I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself before we start. I came to UAF as an undergraduate student from upstate New York, Rochester. Anybody from upstate New York-ish? New York-ish. I don't count New York City as New York, because that's like a little baby island in like real New York. So I came to UAF in 2001 as an undergrad, which was probably before a lot of you were born, which is also embarrassing. I came to UAF as a physics major. I was dead set. I was going to be a high school physics teacher. There was nothing that was going to stand in my way of becoming a high school physics teacher. I graduated in 4 years with a degree in photojournalism and Spanish. So, I just want you to know that it's okay to change your mind, and it's okay to be dead set on something that you really, really think that you want to do and you love, and then come here and change your mind. What happened to me is I just took a couple photography classes, and then I really liked that instructor, so I took some other classes they were teaching, and I took a bunch of Spanish in high school, so I thought, well, if I take another couple classes, I'll have a Spanish minor. And then I just took a couple more classes. You find that you're gonna really fall in love with different departments and professors and other students, and you know, it might take you in directions that are really surprising to you. So I just invite you guys to keep an open mind and allow yourself to explore a little bit and sort of venture outside of your box that you are dead set on. And if you're not dead set on something, academic advisors can help you discover new paths. And we can talk a little bit about that, but I'm getting ahead of myself, so. Okay, so the Family Educational Rights and Protection Act, I should change this slide. I thought forever it was privacy, but everybody was talking about protection yesterday, so I probably should check that. Either way, have you guys, raise your hand if you've heard about like HIPAA for medical records. So it keeps your records private and makes it so that nobody can talk about your medical records unless you release your medical records to be able to be talked about, right? So the FERPA, Family Educational Rights and Protection Act, is the same thing but for your educational records. So what that means is that the minute you enroll in a class, whether you're 15 or 57, you are automatically protected under FERPA, which means if your mom or dad call, your husband or wife, your guardian, your grandma, grandpa, we cannot talk to them about your educational record at all unless you give us permission to talk to them. And there is a form that you can get on the registrar's website that I think your parents all got if they were here, called the FERPA release form. And so that gives you the opportunity to release your records to exactly who you want, when you want, and what part of your records you want available to that person. So, for example, I could say, okay, I want my mom to have access to my account information, but not my grades or anything else. And you can set the exact date that you want that to be active for. You can change your mind anytime you want. So I know students during orientation are encouraged by their parents or guardian to release their records to their parents. And then after they leave, again, they're your records and you have the ability to share with them or not share with them. So just keep in mind that it also allows you to seek and amend any corrections. And also you have the right to view any of your education records while you're here too. So any questions about FERPA? Seems kind of like an enigma, but if you just remember that it just protects your rights and protects your educational record, and you have the right to decide who gets to see it and who gets to talk about it. So just remember, if mom or dad calls and says, I want to pay my son's bill or I want to pay my daughter's bill, can you tell me how much it is? I can't. And sometimes they get grumpy because they want to give me money. But it's really important that you work with your parents to either give them permission to know that stuff or work with them to pay on UA Online, and you can help them with that. So UAF has what's called mandatory advising. What does that mean? That means that every single semester, if you're a degree-seeking student, regardless of if it's your first semester on campus or your graduating semester, you have to meet with an academic advisor every single semester, at least once. What that academic advisor does is works with you to pick out your classes for registration. We can help create an academic plan. We can go through and we help with financial aid issues. We can help you figure out what textbooks you need. We can help you figure out a good schedule if you're living off campus versus on campus. So your relationship with your academic advisor is actually really important. And I don't want you to think that it's just like this hoop that you have to jump through in order to register. Because in my 15 years of being an advisor, I think I can count maybe on one hand the times that a student have come in my office, given me their classes, and I just go, okay, great, sign it, and then they go. Inevitably, there's a conversation that ends up coming up, and we start talking about those classes. Oh, did you know that you've got 15 minutes between your chemistry class in the Reichart building and your English class that's at CTC downtown? Maybe they didn't know that. So working with your advisor is going to be really important to know those things. The other thing, too, that we do is we make sure that you're not taking unnecessary classes. Like, how lame would it be if you get through a semester and then realized, great, I didn't need that English class because I actually got AP credit. Great, so I just wasted time and money. Your academic advisor is going to help make sure that we avoid that at all costs. So if you have AP credit, if you have CLEP, which stands for the college level examination program, there's also DSSTs, which are Dante's tests, credit by exam. There's so many other ways to earn credit outside of just taking a class, and your advisor is going to know about those options. Can you raise your hand if you know another language besides English, even if it's not like totally fluently? Holy macaroni! Okay, did you know you can get college credit for knowing another language? Yeah, okay, so if it's Spanish, French, or German, I think those are the three, you can take a CLEP test and get up to 16 credits of language credits. It's not an all or nothing. It's like a test where you get through it, and based on how far you get through the test, you get so many credits. So that's pretty awesome. If we don't have a CLEP test for the language that you speak, we do partner with Brigham Young University, and they do FLATS tests. And they do language tests for languages that I've like never even heard of before. So if you think that the language that you know is unique enough that they might not have a test, we can check, because I almost guarantee that they do. So talk to your academic advisor about that, because inevitably there's going to be elective credits you might need for your degree. You might need humanities credits. And I'm all about saving time and money. So if that gives you the opportunity to do those things, talk to your advisor. The other thing that's super duper important, yeah, a question, good. Yes. Totally, and that's a really good point. So she said that the CLEP exam costs about, it's like $130, I want to say, because I want to say it's like, I don't know, like some sitting fee to take it in our exam services, and then you actually purchase the test on collegeboard.com, like the same place you do the ACT stuff. But you're right, $150 for potentially 16 credits, when credits are now like, I don't even know what they are now, $250, $260 a credit? I don't even know. They were like 99 when I was a student. That tells you how old I am. But yeah, it's totally the most bang for your buck, for sure. So if you think you want to explore that, come talk to me, come talk to your advisor. It's a great way to rack up those credits and do it pretty inexpensively. Can I see a show of hands of anybody who took an AP test? Keep them up if you got a 3, 4, or 5 on the final test. Whoa. All, see all those hands? Those are all college credits, you guys. Raise your hand if you got a 4 on AP Calc. Ow! Round of applause, yeah. So you got Calc 1 credit, that's awesome. I took Calc 1 AP and I got a 1, which I think you get for writing your name on the paper. Anyway, go ahead. That's a great credit, that's a great credit too. Question, so IB credit, you're gonna wanna work with your advisor on that because there are ways to bring that credit in where we partner with the transfer credit services folks to bring that in. So another example of that is like, let's say you took a couple college classes at home at their community college or you know, sometimes there's dual enrolled classes that you got high school credit and high school credit. You're gonna wanna make sure that you send those final official college transcripts to UAF because that's the only way that we can transfer them in. So it can't be like posted on your high school transcript or like a note written from your counselor. Like it has to be an official transcript from the college in which you took the class. But that's another way to transfer in a ton of credits, yeah. That's a really good question. So if you took UAA credits, you do not have to send a final transcript from UAA, but you do have to tell us that you took UAA credits because it's all in the same system. UAA, UAF, and UAS, we're a family, but I like to say we're sisters in that we're very different, but we are part of the same family. So yeah, you just gotta let your advisor know, and then again, they'll contact transfer credit and bring those in. So you don't have to send transcripts for UAA or UAS. Yeah. That's a good question, whether or not there's review options for the language tests. For CLEP tests, there are. You can buy resources on collegeboard.org. Our library has a bunch of resources. As for the FLATS test, I'm not positive. Oh, yeah, I mean, I think I would probably try and study a little bit before you take it because it's not like a placement test. So a lot of you had to take probably a math placement, the ALEKS, does that sound familiar? I think students, when they go to take that test, they want to study and like get so good. But the thing about a placement test is like it wants to be accurate so that you're not in like a super crazy hard math class or super easy math class, right? So the language tests for credit are a little bit different in that, yeah, you want to study so that you can get as many credits as you can for that. So it's a little bit different than a placement exam. Does that kind of answer your question? Okay, come talk to me afterwards and I'll talk to you more about it, okay? We talked about learning resources on campus. All right, the next slide I'll show you is the learning resources flyer that we put together. So I think probably the biggest, scariest, intimidatingest, is that a word, intimidatingest, thing that college students, I think, are faced with when they come to college is advocating for yourself. I mean, that's huge. When you're in high school, you've got mom, dad, counselor, cousins, counselors, everybody barking at you, telling you what to do and saying that you need help and you need to do this and you need to do this. The thing about UAF is there are so many resources available for students. We have a writing center. We've got like 3 math labs. We've got chemistry help. We've got a speaking center if you have to give a presentation. We've got, what else here? A foreign language lab. We've got so many resources down at CTC if you're taking courses downtown. There's so many resources available, but you have to ask for help. Sometimes that's scary. Sometimes that's intimidating. Sometimes that feels uncomfortable. But I'm trying to normalize it in that successful college students ask for help, and they go to tutoring, and they do practice sessions with their friends and study groups. So I don't want you to think that like, oh, I'm not doing too hot, so I gotta, you know, ask for help. No, no, no. The successful students, the students who do really well, go and ask for help. So by you asking for help, you're gonna be successful. You just gotta ask for it. And I always tell students, like, make sure you have your, like, one person. And that can be your advisor, that can be your orientation leader. Raise your hand if you're an orientation leader in here. Can I have a round of applause for these amazing people? I mean, they have been busting their tails for not just the last 2 days. I mean, like, days and days and days before this with trainings and waking up early and, you know, doing a lot of Logan's grunt work, I think. These guys have been busting their tails. And so they're an amazing resource to you as well. And they're fellow college students like yourself. So if you've got questions, they've probably got answers and they've probably been there. So just ask for help. Don't be afraid to ask for help. And ask for help early and often. Sometimes I'll get students in my office like the week before finals and they're like, yeah, I don't get any of this. So there's not a whole lot I can help you with if you come to me that late in the game. But if the first week or two of classes, you're like, whoa, okay, I need to get in with a study group or a tutor, knowing that early is just going to set you up for success. Don't wait. Don't be embarrassed. Don't think, oh my gosh, I'm the only one here that doesn't know this stuff. I can guarantee you you're not alone. Guarantee. The other thing, just to go back, is we help you plan for future semesters. So UAF only publishes their classes semester by semester, so it's sometimes challenging to put together a schedule before the classes are released for the next semester, but we can certainly make four-year plans of, okay, this class is only offered in the spring, so we gotta make sure we put it in a spring somewhere. We have a new app that's coming out. Have you guys heard of the Nanook Navigator app that's coming out? Okay, cool. So that is going to be, I think, a game changer in that you're going to have, like, your degree plan in the palm of your hand. It's also going to be available on desktop, and you can work with your advisor to, like, take the classes and, you know, plug them into different semesters. It's going to be really, really, really awesome. And I think pretty, what's the word? Not engaging, interactive, innovative. I'm having trouble with the adjectives today. It's early. Okay, so working with your advisor, I've kind of beaten this horse to death, but it's really, really important that you connect with your academic advisor every semester. So where do I find my academic advisor? There's a couple different places. UAF is a little unique in that we have academic advising sort of embedded in a lot of different places. So a lot of schools and colleges have a staff advisor. So for example, if you're in the College of Engineering and Mines, you maybe talk to Joe Alloway. If you're a college of, School of Education, you may have talked to Colleen Angayak. If you're Natural Sciences and Mathematics, you maybe talked to Amy Wald. So we have a lot of staff advisors that are available. Some majors also have faculty advisors that help. Sometimes you start with a staff advisor, move to a faculty advisor. Sometimes you start with a faculty advisor and stay with that faculty advisor. But if you have questions about where to find your academic advisor or you're not sure, please, please, please ask someone because you're really going to want to make sure that you connect with them. Again, if you're undeclared, undecided, or just need help sort of navigating something, please come to the Advising Center. We can help you there. We can help connect you to your advisor if you're not sure who that is. And if you're in an associate's degree or an occupational endorsement or a certificate, your academic advisor is going to be down at our community and technical college, which is part of UAF, just located in a different building in a different part of the city, so downtown. So key to your academic advising appointments. There's a lot of students that need to meet with their advisor, and some of these advisors have a lot of students on their caseload. So it's really, really important to keep your appointment, make and keep an appointment, because if you don't keep that appointment, that takes away for time for another student. And also, it might be harder for you to get in if you miss your appointment. You may not be able to see your advisor for a week or two later. So it's really important to keep those appointments. And also, come prepared. That can mean a couple different things. I don't mean like have a like a accordion folder with your entire life and all your papers. That can just mean come with an opinion. Come with you know, things that you know you want to study. Come with ideas of things you don't want to study. Having some sort of opinion is going to help an advisor, because I can make a great schedule for me. May not be a great schedule for you. So come to those appointments knowing, listen, lady, I am not a morning person. I don't want anything before noon, okay? Or, you know, I really am a morning person. I want to have everything done by 1 p.m. Or I want to keep all my classes on Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays so that I can have Tuesdays and Thursdays open to work. Those things are all pretty possible, but I won't know those things unless you tell me. So make sure you come to your appointments with an opinion and an idea about what you want, okay? The other thing, too, we talked about inquiring alternate ways to earn credit. So, like, if you come and see me and say, you know what, I grew up speaking Chinese, let's talk about that. There's a test that you can take to get credit. If you, let's say you did, I'm just making things up, AP American History in college or in high school, and maybe you didn't take the AP exam, so there was no way you could earn credit. There is a CLEP test for American history. So things like that. Bring those questions to your advisor, because oftentimes there's opportunities that can give you college credit, but you don't know unless you ask, right? Academic difficulties. I said it before and I'll say it again. If you are struggling, if you need help, if you are like, ugh, I don't know where to go, ask someone. Ask anybody who works here. UAF is a pretty amazing place when it comes to people that care about students and care that you succeed. And it's kind of the reason why I stuck around. I came from my undergrad in 2001. I became a staff member in 2005. I worked on a master's degree while I was a staff member. And I haven't left yet. And when I came here from upstate New York in 2001, I said, I'm going to give it a semester. I'm going to try this Alaska thing out. And that was 23 years ago. So Alaska and UAF kind of has a way of sneaking into your blood, and then you start bleeding blue and gold, and then you're like a nanook for life. So the other thing, too, how many have thought about going on exchange or studying abroad? Oh, my God, yes. So Nicole Palash in our office is our study away advisor. Start talking to us early. You can't go your first year, but there are deadlines and application things that have to be met before you can go. But just discovering what options are available, our Study Away website has really, really great information. But come talk to us. Get those hamster wheels churning early so that you know what you need to prepare for that ahead of time. You have to have a certain GPA. You have to have a certain number of credits done before you can go. Also, you want to know if the country you want to go to or the state you want to go to is available. And you can do more than one. You can maybe study a semester in Texas and then go to Japan another year. So there's a lot of opportunities there, and you just want to be planning for that. And doing that ahead of time is only going to make things easier in the long run. And then it's important to keep your personal records. If you work with an advisor to do like a petition, for example, like maybe you did a class at a previous college that didn't quite come in right, and we are using it to petition for a certain class that it didn't come in as, but we want it to come in as that, just keep paper records. Ask for copies from your advisor. If it's digital copies, keep it in your email. It's not often that things get lost or papers get misfiled, but when they do and you can go, nope, it's right here, it's gonna help. So just keep records. It's important. We're adults now. We gotta keep manila folders of things now that you never had to do before. So just make sure you keep those records handy. Okay, so we talked a little bit about academic difficulty, asking for help. You wanna do well, and there's a couple different reasons why. You want to do well because you need a 2.0 to graduate. So if you fall below a 2.0, even if you have everything done, you can't graduate until you have a 2.0. So good standing is a 2.0 cumulative GPA. Now, if you fall below a 2.0 in your first semester, you may be put on what's called academic warning. And it doesn't mean a whole lot for you in terms of like restrictions. But what it does do is it sort of gives your advisor a little bit of a red flag that you might need some help and might need some assistance. What you want to be careful about is
semesters going forward that fall below 2.0 as well. So if you have another semester below 2.0, you can be on academic probation. And what that means is it limits the amount of credits you can take. So you can only take 13 credits. And again, you want to get that cumulative GPA above a 2.0. If by any chance you fall below 2.0 again for another semester and your cumulative GPA falls below a 2.0, you can be what's called academically disqualified. And what that means is that you're no longer a degree-seeking student, and you may have to sit out a semester. There are other scenarios and things you can work out with your advisor, but when you are no longer a degree-seeking student, you no longer qualify for financial aid. So that's the biggie, is that you're limited to 10 credits, and you don't qualify for financial aid. So no scholarships, no loans, no grants, none of those things. So we're hoping that you talk to your academic advisor long before this happens. Yeah. Correct. Yep, 4.0 I think is the highest. We don't have any sort of weighted GPA for like extra special classes. I think 4.0 is the highest for UAF. So 2.0 is a C average. So yeah. Any other questions about this? That's a good question. Oh, attending class. That's like the most important thing. If you take anything away from this presentation, anything at all, go to class. You're paying for it. You're here. If it's an online class, log in. Make sure you log in on that first day. Believe it or not, going to class helps you be a more successful student, because inevitably what's discussed in class, in lectures, in classroom discussions, in message boards on Canvas or Blackboard, more than likely they're going to be on the test. And if you don't go to class, you might miss material that you're going to get tested on. Even if you read the book, you read the notes, you listened to the lectures, go to class. It's really, really important. Ask a buddy to help you wake up, set 4 alarms, do what you need to go to class. It's really, really important. The other thing, too, is raise your hand if you're in a writing 111 class or a public speech class like the COJO 121, 131, or 141. Okay, so all of those classes are required for every single person getting a degree. So if you miss the first or second day of class, they boot you out because they need to make room for more students. So it's really important that you go to those classes because they will drop you for non-attendance. So other ones, you know, you may not be graded on attendance. The professor's like, well, if you come, great. If you don't, that's your bad. So just know it's not like high school and other classes where, you know, you were graded on attendance. You may not be, but that doesn't mean that you don't have to go. You still have to go. So important dates to remember for the fall. This is where you take out your phone and take a picture. It is located on our calendar. And I was going to bring handouts, but I didn't because I wasn't sure how many. And I figured you guys are digital age. You do everything on your phone anyway. If you just even Google UAF academic calendar, you're going to find all these dates. And these are important ones. And the reason being is there's some pretty major things that happen attached to these dates. So what happens Monday? First day of classes. What if I have a class that's Tuesday, Thursday? What do I do? You go on Tuesday, so you don't have to go on Monday. So I do have students that have all their classes on Tuesdays and Thursdays. They don't have anything on Monday, so you don't have to go to class, obviously, on Monday. But Monday is the first day of class. You're going to want to make sure that you go to class. Log in. If you're taking an online class, make sure you log in. Make sure you can get in. If not, talk to your academic advisor. Figure out what your instructor's name is. Email them. Let them know. Yeah. For sure. And that, did you guys hear that? So even if your class starts on Tuesday, you can log in early to your Canvas and check out the syllabi. There may be like homework that might be due that you could get a jump on. But I mean, a lot of online classes, you can even log in now. Like I had a student who logged in yesterday and like the whole class is there. And he's like, whoa, okay, cool. He can start working if you want to. So just make sure that you try and get into your Blackboard or your Canvas and make sure that you see those classes. If you know that you're registered for an online class and you do not see it in there, make sure you talk to somebody. Talk to your orientation leader or your academic advisor, or you can go to the registrar's office and see why that's not showing up. Friday, September 9th. So classes start on a Monday, not the first Friday, but the second Friday is when all tuition and fees are due. So you really want to make sure that you have either set up a payment plan or you've got all your tuition and fees due and paid for by that 9th. Now, that is also the last day to add drop swap classes. So, like, let's say you're registered for, 15 credits, and you go to your first week of classes, and you go, oh, gosh, this is going to be a little much. If you need to drop a class, make sure you do it before the 9th. If you drop a class before the 9th, never shows up on your record. It's like it never was there. You'll get fully refunded if you had already paid for it. If you drop a class after the 9th, it's no longer called a drop. It's called a withdrawal. And what that means is that your tuition and fees do not get refunded, and you get what's called a W on your transcript, which is a withdrawal. It shows whoever's reading your transcript that you attempted a class, you didn't finish it. A W does not affect negatively your GPA, so it doesn't bring it down at all, but it can affect your financial aid if you withdraw from like 2 or 3 classes every single year. It can affect your completion rate. And for federal financial aid, they require you to be at a level of above 67%, which doesn't mean a whole lot to you guys, but they want to see that the credits that you've attempted match the credit that you've earned. If you keep withdrawing from classes or failing classes, that can drop your completion rate, which can affect your financial aid. So just keep that in mind. The other thing is, if after that 9th you're thinking, oh man, I should have done it before the 9th, but I really got to get rid of this class, go talk to your academic advisor, because most of the time the effects of withdrawing from that class on the 10th are going to be the same as, where is it here, November 4th. November 4th is the very last day to withdraw from a class. So that means whether you withdraw from the class on the 10th of September or Friday, November 4th, it's going to be the same outcome. So more than likely, your advisor is going to try and connect you with resources and try and help you out as much as possible to try and bring that grade up. Also, don't jump to conclusions. I think a lot of students, too, that were very academically above average in their high school might get to college and realize the rigor is a little bit more intense and maybe like, oh, my God, I got my first C. I need to drop this class immediately. Hang on. There's a lot you can do to sort of make sure that, you know, you don't dive bomb. There's resources. There's things to help. Don't immediately just drop classes or withdraw from classes the minute you get your first exams score back. Because the other thing is, UAF does not require you to talk to an academic advisor before you add or drop classes or withdraw from classes. But I beg you, like with every inch of my being, to talk to your advisor before you withdraw from a class. And the reason being is it can have some pretty major ramifications for financial aid. So you think, oh, whatever, I'm just withdrawing from this class. I don't want to take it anymore. If you're getting military veterans benefits, sometimes you got to pay those back. If you're getting certain scholarships, you may be not qualified to receive those scholarships in a next semester if you don't complete so many credits. So if at any point you're thinking about changing your schedule, dropping or withdrawing, just check with an academic advisor first. We might just give you the thumbs up, go ahead, and then you're good. But then you know and you're well informed and you're not making a decision that might have some pretty major effects later. Monday, October 10th, which is kind of like halfway through the semester a little bit, is when our early progress reports come out. So we invite instructors to give progress reports on all their students. So Daniel has missed the last like 2 weeks of classes. We might get that, and advisors will reach out to you. So it's kind of like an early semester check-in between the instructors and the advisors to make sure that you guys are supported and taken care of. Yeah, I saw a hand. Yeah. Yes. That's a really, really good question, and I don't have the exact answer for you. So she asked if there was a late start class. So some classes start later in the semester. Some start like halfway into the semester. Some start 2 weeks in. I'd have to double check. And you're going to want to talk to the registrar about that because I think it has to do with the start date. And how many days after that, but let's chat because it's different for every class. There's like some sort of algorithm they use to like figure out the amount of percentage of time that's passed since it started. But it doesn't follow the exact same rules as a class that starts on the first day. So we'll chat. That's a good question. Yeah. I think that they come out all at the same time, regardless of whether they end early or not. Because there are some courses, like, raise your hand if you're in a library science course, Library Science 101. Those tend to be offered kind of funky, where they're a one-credit course, but they're offered in, like, a third of the semester, so they're kind of scrunched. And those dates might be a little bit different too. So this is a very generic date in that your typical classes that are running from the first day of class on the 29th to the last day of instruction on the 10th, those are what these dates are going to be applicable for. They might be a little bit different for the late start classes or the early end classes, but definitely check with your advisor about that. Yeah. Online class? Yep, so you have until I think 11:59 on the 9th to drop a class, but if it becomes the 10th, then it's no longer a drop. So yeah, you just want to make sure. I think you can do it in person till 5 p.m. at the registrar's office on that Friday, but you have until 11:59 if you do it online. The other thing you're going to want to keep in mind is that Wednesday through Sunday is Thanksgiving break, no classes. And then the very last day of instruction is December 10th. And then usually finals go the week after that. So, the reason why I did that is because classes are released October 31st this year. So for spring semester, the courses are released for viewing on October 31st. Registration for the spring starts November 14th. So exactly 2 weeks after you can see your courses, that's when you can register. So that two-week period between Halloween and November 14th is a really, really good time to meet with your advisor. Because that's when you can talk about classes, create a schedule, put everything in your shopping cart, get ready to go when the 14th happens, and then you can check out and register for those courses. And you definitely want to do it between the 14th and the 28th. Excuse me, because the 28th is when registration opens for everybody. So 14th is priority registration. If you're a degree-seeking student, you can do it on the 14th. On the 28th, that's when it opens for UAA students, UAS students, your grandma wanting to take a cooking class. It opens up for everybody on the 28th. Yeah. That's a good question. He asked if during Thanksgiving break, will professors be around to talk to? I think that's dependent on the professor and whether or not they go on vacation or not. That's something that you probably want to work out with them beforehand. Some stick around and are probably more than happy to meet with students, but I do know some professors that are like, let's just not have class this week at all because half the class is going to be gone and I'll just give you extra homework assignments. So definitely talk to your instructors. I think that's probably one thing that's the most unique about Fairbanks and UAF specifically is that our faculty are super duper approachable. We have small class sizes. I mean, sometimes they're like 20, 22 students. I mean, I think the biggest classes we have are maybe some of the natural sciences in those big auditoriums, but I think it's still less than 100, which is kind of unheard of for other big universities. So your professors are going to get to know you. You're going to get to know them. I went to barbecues at my professors' houses. I babysat their kids. Like, they care about you. They want you to be successful, and they want you to do well. And they're not scary. Like, I think you think, oh, my gosh, this professor is probably a PhD in something, and they've been teaching forever. On the top of your syllabi, every single one of your syllabi will have office hours where your instructor is available to talk to. Take advantage of that. Talk to your instructor. Go to their office hours. They're very lonely. They sit there all by themselves if no students come and say hi to them. And when you think about it, that's one-on-one help with the instructor if nobody else shows up. Even if you just go and say, you know, on Friday, I was a little confused about, you know, photosynthesis. You were talking about sun and the plants. Could you just go over this one more time with me? That's huge. You're getting one-on-one tutoring with the professor. And the other thing, too, is if it's maybe the difference between a B minus and a C plus, and I go, whoa, John came to my office every single week, and he worked his tail off. I think that's a B minus. So think about that. A lot of times, instructors will look to see how much effort you put in, how much you're trying, how much you're asking for help, how much you're going to their office hours. Talk to them. Email them. They're not that scary. If you need help trying to write an email to your instructor, if you want to sit through a phone conversation with your instructor, talk to your advisor. I've written many, many faculty emails with students just to kind of help them write that email, and I'm happy to help. All your advisors are happy to help. Okay, so let's recap really quick, and I'm kind of almost on time. I'm pretty impressed with myself. Let's recap. So FERPA, Family Educational Rights and, it's not Privacy, Protection Act. That protects your records. Remember, if you want to give access to any of your educational records, you're going to want to make sure that you do that through the registrar's office. There's a form. They'll want to check your ID. You give permission to who you want and what you want to give permission, whether it's account information, registration information, anything you want, you can give or not give or take away. Mandatory advising. So every single semester, you're going to be meeting with your academic advisor to talk about classes. And I really would recommend you see them more than once a semester because they are going to be your biggest resource for connecting you with help on campus. Lastly, keep your appointment. Definitely create a relationship with your academic advisor who's going to help connect you with faculty, connect you with internships, connect you with resources on campus, math lab, writing center. Talk to your academic advisor. Grades matter, so make sure that you keep in mind that you definitely want to do well in your classes because it could have some pretty major ramifications if you don't do well, and that's on financial aid and scholarships. If you're on an Alaska Performance Scholarship or UA Scholars, there's some certain like credit caps and GPA caps that you have to meet in order to continue receiving that scholarship. So if you have questions about that, you can ask me or your academic advisor. And lastly, the most important thing, what did I say? Gosh, that was pretty lame, you guys. What's the most important thing to do? I love it. I love it. All right, so where can you find us? Fifth floor of the Greening Building, which is in that big, tall, gray building out there. Just hang a left when, no, sorry, a right. Don't hang a left. Hang a right when you exit the elevator, and you'll find us. So before I let you go, who looks the most awake? Everyone's like, can you start the wave? Come on, the wave. Do it. Start on that side. You just got to start it. Somebody's got to start it. Okay. Oh, come on. Okay, come on. Okay. Okay, but what happens if you start it on this end and on this end at the same time? Then what happens? This is like a physics experiment. Let's do it. Okay, ready? Whoa. Okay, I tried. I don't know. I Googled like auditorium icebreakers like 5 minutes before this presentation. One of them involved like writing down your dreams on a piece of paper and then like crumpling it and then like throwing it on stage. And I was like, well, that would be cool until I have to pick them all up. And so thank you guys so much for sitting through this. I know it's super early and you guys have been like probably awake really late these last couple nights. So I'm very impressed that you were here and impressed that you were engaged and awake. Now, the next thing that's happening, I don't know if you wanted to do it or you wanted. So you're going to want to find your academic or your orientation leader. If you're not sitting with your orientation leader, maybe stand up orientation leaders and identify yourselves. We are going to be walking over to the Greening Building where we're going to participate in Academics 102. Which is a short session that you're going to be connected with an academic advisor, and they're going to help facilitate just some discussions around some scenarios that involve like resources on campus, just to kind of get you thinking about possibilities and options. And then I think after that is what, lunch or something? Oh my God, yes, food. Awesome. Well, I'll hang around in case you guys have any questions. Thank you so much. Good luck. I can't wait to hear about all of your adventures, and thank you for coming.